second of the verse. The burning flames have framed in the depths of my heart.
When time scrambles and
okay. Which camera was that? Good morning, everyone. We have not been able to hear any of the opening music in here, so I don't know if that went out or not.
It's going.
Can we lose the opening music then, in case it's still running? Okay. And there's this buzz when I talk that's driving me completely nuts. Please, I beg you guys, do something about that. Okay. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Atheist Experience. This show is brought to you by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. I'm your host, Jeff D. My co-host is Martin Wagner, and today's guest is Howard Thompson. We are live August 6, 2000 CE. The ACA has weekly meetings every Sunday morning at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop at 307 West 5th Street at 10:30 a.m. right after the show, except for the first Sunday of each month when we have our lecture series at 11 a.m. in the Longhorn Room of Furs Cafeteria at North Cross Mall. This month's lecture will be held today, and the speaker will be our own Arlo Pignotti, presenting his Holy Paraphernalia Mania traveling show.
Wow.
That's his personal collection of weird religious trinkets. Nothing like made up. These are all real things sold by real religious people to promote their actual religions. The next lecture will be held on September 3rd, 2000. The speaker will be Dr. William R. Coker of the Department of Physics at the University of Texas at Austin, entitled Fake Science, Anti-Science, and Ignored Science. ACA board meetings take place at noon, right after our regular meeting on the second Sunday of every month. These meetings are open to all ACA members, but you can only vote if you're on the board of directors. The next board meeting will be on August 3. Those of you who shop at Randall's, if you want, you can give them our nonprofit number, which is 5158. And the Godless Gamers meet every Monday night at 7:30 at the home of Vic Ferro. For more information, call our voicemail at 371-2911 or visit our website at www.atheist-community.org. Morning, everybody.
Morning. Good morning, Jeff.
Well, here Happy we are. Happy August.
Is that right?
this is the news segment of the show, so why don't we go straight to Martin for the latest news.
All right.
And that the speaker is still buzzing at me, and it's completely driving me crazy.
Oh, well.
Oh, good grief. Oh, okay.
Well. Oh, he can get used to anything in this life. Okay, now here's the news this morning, folks, for August 6th. Kansas, a rebound. Idiocy has taken a blow. Republican moderates yesterday, that would be August 1st, as of the dateline of this article, Republican moderates ousted several Kansas Board of Education officials during a primary election who had supported new science standards that de-emphasized evolution and made the state the object of derision. The changes came a year after the board, which oversee the content of Kansas public school curriculum and textbooks, voted 6-4 to establish what the Washington Times newspaper described as, quote, the most anti-evolution science education standards in the country. The guidelines declared that, quote, no evidence contradicting a current scientific theory shall be censored, and left the door open for teaching creationism. The modifications to the school guidelines were labeled, quote, a travesty to science education by Dr. John Staver, who chaired the committee that drafted the original language. Quote, Kansas just embarrassed itself on the national stage, he declared, when, in August 1999, the board voted to introduce the creationist language. The move was considered a victory for religious fundamentalists who increasingly have sought to challenge evolution instruction by having disclaimer language in the textbooks, or other theories, usually the biblical account, presented as a credible alternative. For supporters of hard science and evolution, though, yesterday's victory was a sweet revenge. The most hotly contested race was in the 2nd District and saw BOE Chairwoman Linda Halloway, who had championed the new creationist standards, taste defeat at the hands of opponent Sue Gamble, 60% to 40%. Halloway, a former teacher, had raised nearly $90,000 to only $35,000 to Gamble. Even so, Gamble, who is expected to win a November general election challenge from Democrat Ron Patton, a Presbyterian minister, conducted a vigorous door-to-door campaign. Popular support for creationism remains high in the United States, but Monday's Kansas election suggests that when the issue comes under close scrutiny, evolution and hard science standards win the day. Roper, Gallup, and other surveys suggest that nearly 40% of Americans embrace a form of so-called, quote, theistic evolution, where evolutionary processes taking place over millions of years are, quote, guided by a deity. About 45% believe that a god, usually the Judeo-Christian flavor, created the universe and human beings pretty much in their present form at one time or another within the past 10,000 years, according to Dr. George Bishop of the University of Cincinnati. So, as you can see, medievalism and idiocy still has a pretty strong foothold in our culture, and there's a lot to be done in the educational realm to correct that. However, it's not going to be done anytime right away, if this next article is any indication. If today's students want to understand how scientists map the human genetic code, they won't get much help from their high school textbooks, a group of scientists and educators said recently. Quote, textbooks treat the topic piecemeal, leaving out the simple story or obscuring it with needless details, said George Nelson of the American Association for the Advancement of Science. The group leveled its harshest critique yet of U.S. math and science lessons, giving an unsatisfactory rating to all 10 of the major high school biology textbooks it reviewed. Researchers said the books, hundreds of pages long and filled with quizzes and splashy color drawings of cells, miss the big picture. They don't flesh out the four basic ideas driving today's research: how cells work, how matter and energy flow from one source to another, how plants and animals evolve, and the molecular basis of heredity. In addition to glossing over vital concepts to drill students on vocabulary words, the books do not encourage students to examine their ideas or relate lessons to hands-on experiments and everyday life. So, you can see, education is really, really, really lax in this country. But hopefully, you know, we'll get someone in a position to improve that. A bit of nonsense in Georgia, but I'm going to skip over that. Just, you know, creationists trying, our fundamentalists just trying to make, quote, respect for the creator part of the curriculum. And, yeah, of course, they can't do that. So, yeah, it's America, people. No government forcing of religious beliefs. And finally, some good science news. We found a new planet. Sorry, I'm just belching this morning. The discovery of a Jupiter-sized planet in a nearby solar system could provide clues that Earth is unique in the universe. The yet-to-be-named planet orbits the star Epsilon Eridani, the nearest star to that us that astronomers have detected a planet orbiting. Not only is this planet nearby, it lies 478 million kilometers, or 297 million miles, from its central star, roughly the distance from the Sun to the asteroid belt in our own solar system. The similarities of the Epsilon Eridani system to our solar system mean it could harbor a terrestrial planet, like Earth, that could sustain life. Quote, it probably would have a chance of having life-bearing worlds, said one of the scientists who made the discovery, adding that an Earth-like planet probably would be inside the orbit of the newly discovered planet, where it would receive more warmth from the star. But another scientist, Jeff Marcy, pointed to a difference that might make Earth unique. Most of the planets in our solar system move in nearly circular orbits, he pointed out. The new planet has an oblong orbit, as do most of the other newly discovered planets, like around other stars. This suggests the architecture of our solar system may be abnormal. We have a burning question as to whether our solar system is a rarity in the planetary zoo. It may be that life here is possible because of the circular orbit. Well, it's all very interesting, so we'll see what we find out from there. And that is the news for August the 6th.
Thank you, Martin.
You're welcome.
I actually had a fundamentalist try to tell me that the Earth must be unique because most of the planets that we had detected so far were Jupiter-sized planets in inner orbits, and therefore there wasn't room for Earth-like planets.
Well, it's only those particular solar systems.
We've only detected mostly that kind so far because of the method we're using for detecting them, which is the gravitational pull of the planet causing the target star to shift. Right, so it was just an amazing eagerness to misinterpret the information we've gotten so far.
We found those kinds of planets because right now they're big enough for us to find. We don't have the capacity to find the tiny ones yet.
Though this orbital thing is a different issue, and of course,
Well, it just goes
perhaps
to show
the
that the
creationists could have made a better argument, but they didn't.
Well, it just goes to show that there's still much more to discover and learn about our universe.
Yeah.
And all the answers have not been answered, as creationists seem to think they have.
Certainly not. Time for a quick Rapture report before we go to Howard.
Okay.
Wait. Actually, before we leave the news segment, here is a quick thing that I found.
Oh, okay.
Lord of the Rings more popular than the Bible.
Yay.
Lord of the Rings is more popular than the Bible, according to a new survey. J.R.R. Tolkien's fantasy novel beat Jane Austen's classic Pride and Prejudice to the top spot in a W.H. Smith survey. The Bible came third.
Well, once again, it's just the people who took that survey.
The survey was to promote the annual Thumping Good Read Award.
That's so
English. W.H. Smith is a chain of booksellers and news agents in UK.
Thumping Good Read. That's so British.
Yeah.
I love it.
Okay. quick Rapture report, just to bring us up to date. In July, Melody Mehta drew data from such prophetic heavyweights as Gordon Michael Scallion, Nostradamus, and Mother Shipton, and claimed that Phobos, one of the moons of Mars, would be knocked out of orbit by a passing comet.
Oh.
And it's supposed to come crashing down on the Earth. Well, that was supposed to happen sometime in July, and it didn't. What a surprise. This month, predictions to what are apocalypses to watch out for.
Okie doke.
Ephraim, somebody goes by the name of Ephraim, says it's time to begin preparations for the Battle of Armageddon. Reinterpreting the book of Daniel for the umpteenth time, he arrives at a timeline for the last days with the Battle of Armageddon beginning on August 20.
Okay.
Unfortunately, his timeline called for the rapture to occur in March. Unless we're going to get an Armageddon without a rapture, that's pretty unlikely. Well, not that it wasn't pretty unlikely to begin with.
Well, true.
Marilyn Agee's rapture prediction number 10.
Again?
After yet another spectacular failure, she's reinterpreting the scriptures and grasping at new straws. She's also predicting August 20. There's no stopping a truly determined doomsayer.
Who is she again? I mean, what is her tradition?
I don't know. I don't know her background. I just know the name. It keeps coming up month after month after month. She makes new rapture predictions pretty much for the next month after her last one.
You got to wonder what people like that get out of this. I mean, just what do they get out of it?
I think that first of all, they want their religion to be true. It adds a certain amount of excitement to your life to think that the world is about to be destroyed. You know.
If that's your idea of excitement.
I'm just guessing here. Maybe we can have some rapture mavens call on the phone and tell us why they think they need to keep predicting the end of the world. We stopped getting our Nostradamus guy. Remember him?
Oh, yeah, vaguely.
We had a Nostradamus guy. It was mostly back when Ray was hosting
the show.
I
heard him a couple co-host. Times.
I think we finally convinced him that he was wasting his time.
He realized it was just all...
Okay, and I don't have my normal announcements here with me today, but the one big one that is still there is in September, and I don't have the exact date. Again, if you need more information, call our voicemail number at 371-2911. But in September, the Committee for the Scientific Investigation of Claims of the Paranormal and the Council for Secular Humanism are going to be hosting a seminar entitled The Bible, Paul, Jesus, and the Facts at the Omni Hotel South Park. There is a fee to get in. You'd have to check their website to find out what that is. Yeah. We're just letting you know that that's happening.
I'm quite looking forward to that, actually.
Okay, Howard, welcome back to the show.
Hi, Howard.
We haven't had you on for a little while.
Martin? Yeah, good to be here.
What do you got for us today?
Well, I was going to come back to one of those things that Christians don't like to hear about, especially those who believe that the United States was founded as a Christian nation. I'm going to come back to some of the history that seems to keep getting lost over time. Well, that's a good echo. the history of the United States that pretty much puts the lie to a lot of things that people who want to restore some type of mythical Christian golden age you keep going to. Now, you're all familiar with the myth of the Christian United States.
Excuse me a second. I got to talk to the control room. We're now getting a buzz when Howard talks, which we didn't have before. Okay. Go ahead, Howard. Sorry to interrupt you, man.
We've all heard of the myth of the Christian United States, and it runs something like this. Christians seeking religious freedom founded our nation as a place where they could properly obey God's law. Puritans and others founded biblical law colonies that established a Christian culture. Christian leaders and ideals thus generated the American Revolution of personal freedom and a constitution based on the Bible and Ten Commandments. Bad things now happen because we have fallen away from our founders' Christian values. America now needs religion and government and laws promoting religion so we can restore our lost golden age of Christian faith. That's pretty much what Pat Robertson and Dobson and John Hagee and other ministers are selling on television. That's pretty much what their books are saying in the bookstores. But they don't tell you the whole story, and they don't tell you a lot of things which contradict their myth. For example, during the time of the American Revolution, only 17% of the people were religious adherents going to church. This figure comes from a book called The Churching of America, 1776 to 1990, by Fink and Stark from Rutgers University in 1992. And it's based on some actual data of the number of churches and the number of ministers there were back then. So it's probably very difficult for someone to claim that the United States was a Christian nation at a time of the American Revolution and the Constitution when only one person in six was actually going to church. Obviously, five people in six were doing something else, and it wasn't going to church, which was pretty much an upper-class thing at those days.
They were probably all farming and trying to catch their dinner.
And probably going out and trying to get land and doing lots of other things.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have a lot of the Christians who want this myth of the Christian United States to be true talk about the Declaration of Independence, and that the Declaration of Independence talks about God, and you know they'll fold their arms and act very smug about this. But when you start looking at history and start figuring out what the Declaration of Independence is really saying, it gives a completely different story. Jefferson opens up in the very first paragraph, and he's not talking about Jesus or Paul or salvation or resurrection or heaven and hell, Christian things. He's talking about, quote, the laws of nature and nature's God, end quote. Now, that's a deistic natural religion sort of talk. Jesus isn't mentioned. Christianity doesn't appear in the Declaration of Independence at all. The Creator is only cited towards the end to justify human rights. They appeal to a judge of the world for help, but the declaration is made in the name and the authority of the good people of these colonies, not in the name of God, not with any obedience to God. So when they go to the Declaration of Independence, people should go pick it up and read it and try to understand it, because it's not saying what they say it's saying. Then you get to the Constitution, which of course is the law of our land and the document which most represents what America is all about. And you'll find something unique in the Constitution. First of all, during the Constitutional Convention, these men, which many Christians will all claim were Christians, did something very strange for Christians. They did not open the sessions of the 1787 Constitutional Convention with prayers. In fact, they were some weeks in when Benjamin Franklin put forward a motion to begin sessions with prayers, since they were having some difficulties, and he hoped this might help them get across those difficulties. And the motion was allowed to die by adjournment. Some Christians who've read these notes of Madison who describe this will say, oh, that was only because they didn't have enough money to pay for a clergyman, which was the form of Franklin's motion. But there was a second motion made by Randolph of Virginia to just read prayers before the sessions of the Constitutional Convention, and that one failed by adjournment too. So they had two chances to vote for prayer at their sessions, and they let both of them go by, which gives a good example of what they were trying to accomplish and what they were not trying to accomplish. And John Adams summed it up quite well in this quote of his about how they went about writing the Constitution and creating our government. This is John Adams, second president of the United States. Quote, "The architects of American government never had interviews with the gods or were in any degree under the inspiration of heaven. Neither the people nor their conventions, committees, or subcommittees considered legislation in any other light than as ordinary arts and sciences. The people were universally too enlightened to be imposed on by artifice. Governments thus founded on the natural authority of the people alone, without a pretense of miracle or mystery, and which are destined to spread over the northern part of the whole quarter of the globe, are a great point gained in favor of the rights of mankind. Notice that his emphasis is on the rights of mankind, not appealing to rights given by God or anything of that nature. And then we get to the Constitution that they actually wrote. And it's quite a revealing document. It's the first attempt, successful attempt, in the history of Christendom to establish a government that rejected the authority of God. We the people ordained our Constitution and established the United States of America. We did not claim authority from God for it, and that was the first time in Christendom that that had happened. And you'll notice that that was already foreshadowed in the language of the Declaration of Independence. Now, in the Constitution that our founders gave us, they very deliberately put in the Constitution the powers that government was to have. Only those powers that were in the Constitution and listed there are powers government had. There was no power to do anything religious. The key thing about this is they did go to the trouble of putting in words to promote the progress of science. So clearly, if they had wanted to promote religion and mention it specifically, they would have, and there was a section in there for that, and they could have done that, but they did not do it. The presidential oath in the Constitution is godless. The only time that religion is mentioned is in a prohibition against religious tests for office. Very clearly, this is a secular document establishing a secular government that has nothing to do with religion, quite deliberately. Now, there were people who wanted to have more rights explicitly mentioned and enumerated, which is the eventual source of the Bill of Rights. One of the defenses that the framers of the Constitution had that was an argument that the Bill of Rights was not necessary was that since there were no powers given to government to do anything religious, there did not need to be a Bill of Rights which expressly protected religious freedom or which expressly forbid government to do anything religious. But the popular demand for a Bill of Rights was quite strong, and so in 1789, the first Congress under the Constitution, they did have a Bill of Rights, and they did something very interesting in keeping with the pattern of the Constitution. The First Amendment opens with the words, "Congress shall make no law." Okay, there are those who want to read into this amendment some power for government to do religious things, but when you have an amendment that begins with "Congress shall make no law," it's clearly a prohibition and cannot be used to authorize government to do anything. And then it does the two-prong statement on religion. No law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Okay, that's a two-edged sword which says Congress shouldn't do anything at all about religion. Now, I know that there are people who will point to all kinds of examples through American history of public officials and government bodies doing religious things, paying for religious things, reporting, supporting religious things, making statements positive of religion, opening sessions of various governmental bodies with prayers, and all of those are just simply violations of what the Constitution actually said. James Madison talked about, for example, the congressional chaplains as being a violation of the First Amendment separation of religion and government, and that was in writings of his called an Essays on Monopolies. So they understood what it was back then, but that doesn't seem to have stopped religionists over the years from injecting religion into government and trying to find various subterfuges and outright distortions of constitutional law to try to find a justification for it. The bottom line is this: the Constitution is the supreme law of the land. Public officials take an oath to uphold the Constitution, and a long tradition of violating the Constitution doesn't change the law. If it did, then there are people who could claim that they had been smoking pot for 50 years, they had a long tradition of it, so obviously the law was invalid in their case. You know, it's a bunch of baloney. End of story.
All right.
Thank you, Howard. We have had Bob on the line here for quite some time. Thanks, so, Bob, for holding on. We are going to go to that call right now.
All right, then.
Hello? Hello, Bob.
We are...
I don't hear a thing.
We are Bobless.
We do not appear to be hearing Bob. Okay, let's put Bob back on hold and try the other line.
With.
Chances are, though, my suspicion is that there is a technical problem.
Whoa.
Hello, Tom? Right. Tom? Hello? No, we are not hearing any of the callers. I'm putting them both back on hold.
Gee, that's a switch.
Until we hear that. Try again. Okay. Bob? No. No, Bob. Bob, please stay on the line. Vic, what's the problem? Okay. Should I go back on hold? Okay. Sorry about that, guys. Please stay on the line. Bob, I know you've been on there for quite a while. Let's see if we can come up with something else I'm using to talk about.
Maybe we ought to talk about the ACA's membership drive that's coming up.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, very much.
That's a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can we talk about that on the show? We can't talk about...
What's prohibited?
If it's as new as you can.
Yeah, well, I mean...
We're trying to get a lot more people to join our group. I think that's about all we can say. Because, you know, we're doing great, but we would like to grow. We would like to be big enough that... that we can be more than we are at the moment.
And we've been seeing a bunch of new people lately at the Bagel Shop.
Oh, yeah. It's not like we don't get new. Oh, that's something we can do.
What's
Vic,
that?
We got that videotape? Well, why don't you do that? We have some footage of an actual atheist bagel shop meeting. that we're going to show for you. So you folks at home will know exactly what sort of things go on at these... atheist community of Austin meetings.
Okay.
As soon as Vic tells me, we've got that tape ready to roll.
This is like a National Geographic thing.
And
atheists in their natural habitat. Okay.
Okay.
All
right. Going to have to reboot the entire phone system, guys. You're going to have to call back. I apologize for that, but it's all part of live television.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know it's highly unusual. We never usually have phone problems, so this is a real inconvenience to people.
So Bob and Tom, we knew you were there, but we couldn't get you get your voice coming out here in the studio.
So
please call back in 5 minutes. Okay, we'll let you know when they've got the phone system bad up.
Oh, they can
call back now. You can okay.
Okay.
You can call back immediately. I don't know why I was told 5 minutes.
Okay.
So what about that tape, Vic?
Well,
you getting there?
I guess he's still working on it.
Standing by.
We're standing by.
Yeah.
You know, I had an interesting thought a few weeks ago when you were out of town. I hosted, and we were just getting the usual litany of our callers who were very, very fanatically creationist, and it struck me that, you know, I said, what is this? What can I compare this to? What is this like in our culture today? Because it's a form of denialism, and for a while, it took me a while, but I thought it's very similar to two other cultural phenomena that are going on right now. It seems it's very similar in some ways to Holocaust denial.
Uh-huh.
Okay, which is basically, oh, well, we don't like, you know, this certain small group of people doesn't like what history has to say about something, so they're just going to decide it wasn't true. And there's another really disturbing, eerie current trend, which is HIV denial.
Yeah.
Which is the idea that...
Oh, that's kooky.
Yeah. And I think what you find in both of those are these are ideas that are being sort of proposed by groups of people for whom if the scientific facts make the way they want to live their lives kind of inconvenient.
Yeah.
You know, in Holocaust denial, what you have are basically white supremacists who think white supremacy is an okay way to think about things. Okay, and then when you point out, well, the last time this sort of thing was done on a big, like, nationwide scale, they rounded up a bunch of people and murdered them, that's kind of bad from a PR standpoint, so I think they just kind of want to say to themselves, oh, no, that didn't happen, and there's no evidence that happened, despite the fact, of course, there's mountains of evidence that happened.
Yeah.
And Michael Shermer, who is editor of Skeptic, and he's written a bunch of really good books, like Why People Believe Weird Things and How We Believe, has just come out with a new book called Denying History, which is all about Holocaust denial, and I haven't read it yet, but I've seen it, and I'm very interested in picking it up.
Should we go back to the phones yet?
Yeah.
We should.
Yeah.
It struck me that evolution denial was similar to that.
I see what you're saying. Yeah. Let's try Bob.
Hello?
Bob.
Hello?
Hi, Bob.
We got him, finally.
Hi.
Thanks
what
for,
can we do for you?
Thanks for sitting and waiting on us, sir.
Yeah. The only question I have about atheism is Is it a protest or a counter reaction to organized religious falsehoods, lies, deception, manipulation, and persecution throughout the centuries?
Well, it can be.
Okay.
I mean, the only reason that that any of us, I think, are so vocal about this silly thing of like what we happen not to believe in, is because we're so completely inundated on all sides by people pressuring us to believe in those things. And you know, I mean, if there were no theism, why atheism wouldn't be an issue at all. So to that extent, it's reactionary.
Okay, I'm sorry. Is my voice too loud?
No, you're fine. You're fine.
Okay.
And getting feedback over your television set?
And that was just part of the other half of the question.
Okay.
Or are there atheists at all who study history, the Bible, other religious and spiritual work, psychic phenomena, positive thinking, and living, and meditation? Or do atheists just try to discredit organized religion and stuff like I've just mentioned because it's been shoved down all of our throats for so long?
Okay, good question. The best way to discredit something, it seems to me, is to first of all understand it. Okay, we're constantly getting phone calls from creationists who are trying to discredit evolution when they clearly don't understand what they're talking about. You know, I mean, you can't very well make an argument that a thing is not true if you don't understand what the claim involved there really is. So you'll find atheists studying all kinds of things in order to better understand it. And it's only when it turns out that having looked more closely that the evidence is that those claims are just not true, then that's what we'll say.
Mm-hmm. I think that you've disproved 99% or actually all of the callers I've ever seen on some of the shows that I've watched of yours who make such claims because they base their claims on faith. It's like you have to have faith or you're going to burn in hell for eternity and you're going to be tormented, tortured that way. I mean, to me, that's just a tool that religion has used for centuries to control the masses.
And isn't it amazing that so many people don't have a moral quandary about that? I mean, think about what it's saying. Join our God's fan club or get tortured forever.
Well, you see,
I mean, how can anybody support any group that said something like that?
Well, you're exactly right, and violence to me is not a solution to solving a problem. I'm a little more optimistic than that, and I don't disbelieve in God, and I don't believe in a God. I would have to base my beliefs on facts, on scientific facts as well as spiritual facts, if I could actually experience something spiritual to where I actually knew or believed that there was a God.
Right. Now,
I don't know.
When you say that you don't disbelieve, that's a key point in understanding atheism. The theists love to characterize atheists as people who are making a positive claim that they know for certain that God doesn't exist, right? And that's really not the definition of atheism used by most atheists. Atheism is merely the lack of the positive belief that he exists. And by that definition, if you don't believe he does exist, then you're an atheist. The question of whether we make definite claims about the non-existence of things depends on the specific thing we're talking about and what the evidence is.
And I think I've gathered that from how I've heard at least y'all talk on previous shows and other atheists in general. I would like to be a little more optimistic myself, and I'm not putting you down, but I mean, I would certainly hate to think that there wasn't an intelligent creator or something.
Why is that?
Or that there would never, that life would not go on after just one single lifetime of however many years.
But do you think that that is the case?
See, I'm more logical. You could call me Spock. I would have to base my stuff on logic. I'm not going to believe something or try to have faith.
Yeah, if you're saying that, boy, it would be nice if, say, there was a heaven that you go to when you die so you get to exist forever, hey, I'm right there with you, right? Of course it would be nice. But that's not the issue, right? The issue
right.
Is it probably true or not? And
but are there
evidence
atheists
appears to be
who,
it's probably not true.
Are there atheists who study both sides of
sure.
the issue?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, that was my point.
That's your point because
yeah, I mean,
you
it's an
study.
Uninformed atheist who knows nothing about that which he says he doesn't believe.
But I believe that, I don't know, I think that there's a possibility of the supernatural, and I'm curious, I would like to experiment with a Ouija board, and I hear people talk about false things, they say, oh, well, bad spirits will take you over, it's a gateway to evil spirits. I mean, why not yeah. good spirits if there's such a thing as a spirit?
Well, I remember seeing an episode a few months back of a really good show that was on a Fox Family Channel called Exploring the Unknown. I don't know if they're still running it, but it's basically a show that deals with like paranormal claims and psychic phenomena and ghosts and things like that, but from a skeptical point of view. And they did a segment on Ouija boards, and essentially all you have going on with Ouija boards, as far as what the evidence shows, is just the power of suggestion and imagination.
Well, it could be your subconscious, and our minds are very powerful.
Yeah.
I mean, who knows whether it's an outside entity or our own subconscious.
Well, if you want to claim, okay, there's a possibility that there's an outside entity doing it, well, then that, I think, would involve another whole battery of tests and experiments to determine exactly what this outside entity was and how it was exerting some sort of influence.
Have you heard of Bullock Jones?
No.
Alex Jones.
Oh,
Alex
my gosh.
Jones. Alex Jones.
Yeah, thanks for your
Alex
call.
Jones.
Boy.
Well, he went into the weird land for a minute.
Yeah, right. We have that video ready. Let's show that now. Folks, this is what it's like at our, just a quick view of what it's like at our weekly meetings.
All right.
Hi, folks. We're here at the Hot Jumbo Bacon Shop to pay a visit to the Atheist Community of Austin weekly meeting. This is the kind of thing that goes on every Sunday morning right after our TV show. Come on, let's see what else is going on here.
I'm the camera
for the TV show.
Well, okay.
Here's Martin Wagner, the co-host.
Might
just sitting here like a normal person.
I'm a normal person.
Anything funny in your mailbox?
You were warned. You're
a TV crowd. And we just get together to chat and socialize and nothing heavy. So. This is what it's like. Everyone down any Sunday morning except the first Sunday of the month when we have our lecture series elsewhere. And sit down and join us. Thanks a lot.
All right. That was interesting.
So that's that.
Huh.
We taped that last week, and of course,
weird.
This is the wrong week to show the tape because this is one of those weeks when we have our lecture series at in the Longhorn Room of Furs Cafeteria at North Cross Mall instead of that bagel shop meeting. But every other Sunday, every Sunday other than the first Sunday of the month, we meet down there at the bagel shop at 10:30, right after this show. So atheists and atheist-friendly people, come on down. It's nothing heavy. It's just a bunch of intelligent, caring, friendly people sitting around
like
socializing. Okay.
All right.
And now we're getting.
Well,
I don't know what that is.
Sputtering and chirping.
So. Yeah, the speakers are sputtering at us.
Oh well.
Okay.
Well, hopefully we'll be able
to
hear.
Can we lose Bob from the list? He's gone, right?
Yeah. He's really gone. He's just totally sounded like his batteries ran out. What happened to him?
Who's next?
Tom on 4, I believe.
Hello, Tom.
Hey, I'm Tom on 4. How's it going, guys?
Hi, Tom.
Just fine. Thanks for hanging in.
Yeah, no problem.
What's up?
I had a question about, actually, you guys kind of started talking about it already, but you and the other guy kind of started to talk about maybe the definition of atheism.
Uh-huh.
And you were talking about, the word atheist means, you know, the belief in that there's not a God.
No.
Well,
Theist means somebody who believes in God,
right?
And A means not,
right?
So
you are
atheist is not somebody who believes in God,
right? But the definition you gave of what an atheist is closer to what an agnostic truly is.
Ah, now then this comes up all the time. The the
an agnostic is one who doesn't know. Not knowing that there's a God, and that's more
agnosticism. No, wait a minute. The term was coined by Huxley, who came up with it because
Aldous Huxley.
Was it Aldous? I know there's two, and that's why
I'm the
first
name.
I'm not absolutely certain, but his point was, I'm not going to engage in these kinds of discussions because the God word that these people are talking about, as I understand it, couldn't be proved, even if it existed. Okay, so agnosticism is a statement about what kind of knowledge is possible.
Right. Okay.
Okay, and atheism, by contrast, is a statement about what you happen to believe. It's possible to be an atheist and an agnostic. If you think it's not possible to really know, but you've decided that you don't believe, you're an atheist agnostic. It's also possible to be an agnostic theist. If you do, in fact, I've met a lot of these people who do believe, but admit that it is impossible to prove it.
I don't like when Christians call or talk to an atheist, and I think it's totally illogical to ask you guys to prove that there is no God, because I understand logically the burden of proof is on the one who says he does believe. But since you guys don't have to prove, and you really can't prove that there's not a God, you guys have to have faith, just like we have faith that there is a God. I don't like that Christians try to prove beyond any shadow of a doubt that there is a God, because if we could do that, and I don't know, a lot of Christians out there might want to hear this, but if we could actually prove beyond any shadow of a doubt that there was a God, then you're not truly a Christian. Because Christianity is based on having faith that there is one. I'm just saying that in the same way, you guys have to have the same amount of faith to say there's not a God.
Well, it's different.
Okay. In fact, I am an agnostic with relation to some specific God claims.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, the omnipotent God who just doesn't want to be found, right? Well, you could never prove that existed.
Right.
I am a theist with regard to some other gods, like South Sea Islanders who worship a totem pole and say that's their god. I think it exists. I may disagree with them about what its supernatural powers are, but I certainly agree that their god exists. And I am a hard atheist, meaning I do assert the non-existence of certain gods. For example, the universe-creating, omnipotent, omniscient, omnibenevolent God who is supposed to have created a universe where there is evil, okay?
Right.
Because he couldn't have been too weak to stop there from being evil, he couldn't have not known how to stop evil, and he couldn't have not cared.
Right.
So if there's evil, that God doesn't exist. That can be disproved logically.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it depends on the specific claim.
Right. How long have you been? Did you grow up in a family that was atheist, or did you?
Both became Methodist ministers.
Okay.
A few years after I was out of the house, they met as missionaries in Cuba just before Castro, and then came back to the States, got married, and had legitimate jobs for most of my upbringing, but were religious. And as soon as me and my brothers were out of the house, they went off to seminary, took the courses, and became ministers.
Your brothers, you mean? My parents
became ministers.
It's interesting because I know most of my friends that are atheists, I only have like three or four, but they have come from, I would say strong Christian, like either parents or whatever, and it, I guess somewhere along the line you get totally turned off by it, or...
I actually have a very nice relationship with my parents. I just happen to disagree
with
them on that issue. Yeah. Would you guys care to?
Yeah, I grew up in a Southern Baptist church. I'm sorry, Jeff.
I was going to have Howard go first since he hasn't said a thing since.
I apologize, Howard.
Go
ahead, Howard, and then I'll follow up.
Go ahead, Howard.
Very briefly, I grew up in an Episcopal family and never had any relationship to what was going on in church. I was just always sitting there waiting for it to end so I could go home and play.
Mm-hmm.
Last time I went to church was at 13, and then My ex-wife talked me into getting married in church in my early 20s.
Mm-hmm.
But I did want to go back and address one point you talked about on faith, that both Christians and atheists equally believe based on faith. I think that statement's probably untrue, depending on how you define faith. The difference is the information that you use for constructing what you believe about reality. And I believe in a materialistic reality that doesn't have gods or anything supernatural, and I base that on the evidence of reality that I see around me. I think a Christian, on the other hand, bases their idea of reality that they believe in somewhat on the material evidence, but mostly on a supernatural source of information, divine revelation from whatever source they get it.
Either right.
voices speaking to them, or a holy book, or our minister that they trust, something of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there's a qualitative difference in the kinds of information that it's based on. My faith, if you want to call it faith, is something that I can go out and test in the real world and prove. You know, I can. You know, I believe in the law of gravity. You know, and it works every time that I do it. I don't believe that God can come along and turn the water in Jeff's cup into wine instantaneously just by somebody saying a prayer over it.
Right.
You know, so there's a difference in the basis of our beliefs. The atheist mm-hmm. accepts reality and tries to live in it and understand it. And from the atheist viewpoint, the religionist, whether they live in reality or not, is trying to get information from some other source, which we regard as unreal and fantastic and certainly unprovable.
I guess you're the guy in the middle. Your parents were Methodist missionaries. The gentleman who was just talking to me, you said you're Episcopal.
Episcopal. My parents are Episcopal.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then the other gentleman was Southern Baptist.
Yeah, I grew up in a Baptist church, and actually all through my early through junior high years up to my early high school years, and actually have quite pleasant memories of it. We did a lot of fun mm-hmm. things. I remember going to camp and there were a lot of like lock-ins and various youth activities that I was involved in, and I had a lot of really good friends and had a ton of fun. So my memories of actually attending church and the Sunday school and being involved in that, I was like in the choir and did one of the musicals. That's all very fun and very pleasant memories. My rejection of religion was based upon something else entirely, and that was based upon just thinking about what I was being told.
Mm-hmm.
And just gradually this whole idea that I simply couldn't get behind this idea of
right.
a God that would torture people forever just because they would question his existence or have doubts. And then coupling that with a lot of just the activities of the far religious right that was going, this was in the 80s, so the Reagan years.
Mm-hmm.
And A lot of things that fundamentalists were doing that was turning me off. And I was also reaching a point in my education where I was taking a much greater interest in science and the scientific method and skeptical inquiry. And all those things just served to whittle away at the core beliefs. Even though I had fun at church, I could just,
mm-hmm.
there was a certain age I reached where I could just, you know, no longer justify going.
Hmm.
Because, you know, despite the fact that a lot of my friends were there and it was a fun place to be and we had good times, it just, you know, the underlying message behind it all, I just didn't think was, you know, was true.
So. What's the name of the suspender wearing?
That's
guy?
Jeff. I'm Jeff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Vic, you should probably put our name tags up when we speak.
Jeff, you said something interesting about you couldn't deny like the tribe that might be worshiping their totem pole or whatever, and obviously that.
Well, if they told me that carved wood there was their God, I would believe that their God existed.
In a similar way, though, Christianity is that same type of thing, because what we worship, we do believe to still be alive. And
but they can't show it to me. That's the difference.
Right.
I can go to the South Sea Island. I can wrap on the big hunk of wood
right.
and
well, there
feel
you
it
go.
And know that it's there.
They
and
can't show it to you.
Yeah.
But it is in a book that has existed for a long time. The account that he did still live, and he left and is still alive. So.
But you know the.
Do you still need to see
the Iliad and the Odyssey are books that have existed for a long time, and those books don't chronicle any deaths of their immortal gods. So, do those gods exist?
Well, they may not chronicle deaths, but they don't specifically chronicle the the coming back to life either.
Well, they don't have to. They claim that those gods were immortal to begin with.
Right, but our book...
My point is that that an old the existence of an old book that says a thing is really not evidence
unto itself.
Well,
then where do you get history from? Where do you get science from? Where does anything like that come? That's why I don't understand. Why at some point do you guys say, well, religion doesn't fall into that same category? Anyone who's talking about religion, you just can't trust it. It's lies. It's fake. It can't be seen as historically correct in any way.
Well, it's lack of evidence. Okay.
To you, though.
No. There are some basic principles of how you identify what's valid evidence and what isn't.
Okay.
And Martin wanted to respond to this. I'll let him.
Okay.
Yeah, I was just gonna. Well, you got right into it. I was just gonna say. Yeah, I mean, okay, that's a valid point. For example, if you don't want to trust, you know, the Bible's veracity just because it's old, you know, how can you know anything? I mean, you know, how can you know, say, Shakespeare wrote his plays and not somebody else, things like
right.
that?
Right, which actually, by the way, is up for debate, too, but anyways.
Well, not among, I guess, real English scholars.
But, right.
You know, I mean, there's some clowns think that Francis Bacon did it, but he didn't.
Right.
Anyway, the point is, when you're looking at any book, okay, just because there's a book on something, you can mm-hmm. go to the bookstore and you can find books on science, biology, paleontology, what have you. And
sure.
you can also find books that tell you that the face on Mars is a big alien thing and that UFOs really land and that by rubbing crystals you can commune with people who've been dead for 35,000 years.
Right.
You know, you have to take each individual book and look at, first off, what is the degree of scholarship that went into it? Who wrote this thing? What are this person's credentials? And what have you?
Right.
So you have to kind of look at what went into the writing of the book before you can begin to take just a book itself as anything that is verifiable. So for example, if you were to take, say, a current up-to-date biology book
mm-hmm.
and look at it and say, okay, well, this is written by, you know, somebody who has actually gone out in the field and spent 30 years in his field studying this and accumulating this knowledge before writing this book, you can then generally look at that and say, I can probably consider this person to be a reliable source. Now, in the case of a religious text like the Bible, what you actually have is not a book, it's a series of books.
Sure.
As well as a few dozen letters that were actually tossed in.
Mm-hmm.
And this was accumulated over a period of centuries.
Mm-hmm.
And it is known to have been, you know, rather extensively edited by, you know, the church leaders in the first century, around the first century. I think the Bible as we know it took its form around the year 100 or so, 150.
No, 400.
400? Okay, so even later than that. So it has gone through, it is a multitude of sources that are basically taking oral histories and have written them down and then have just sort of cobbled them together, and then later on these have been edited by a church which has a vested interest in promoting its religious belief into the kind of the form that we know it now. And it's really difficult after it has been through all these stages to be able to go back and determine who wrote the original document.
Right.
There's a great book on that subject called Who Wrote the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Author's name escapes me, but he's
Friedman.
Friedman. He's a Jewish scholar.
Okay.
Who does have religious beliefs, but takes a scholarly approach to determining the origins of these individual documents, and it turns out, based on his scholarship, and you can read his book and decide whether you think
mm-hmm.
that he has done his detective work properly or not.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some mysterious things in the Bible, like the two accounts of the creation of the universe in Genesis,
right,
back to back, at least two sets of Ten Commandments,
three.
Right, two in this very same chapter, what he's come up with is that the early kingdom of Israel got divided into two parts. There was Judah and I think the other part was called Israel, but they had essentially the same religion and essentially the same oral tradition. They went off and wrote their own accounts when they were separated into two kingdoms.
Okay.
And then later when they got reunited, the two accounts were sifted back together in an apparent attempt to satisfy everyone who was part of this newly reunited kingdom.
Right.
All right. And they determined this by looking at the structure of the sentences and figuring out which lines follow with which other lines.
Yeah, right.
And it's absolutely fascinating.
Yeah, one author refers to God as Jehovah, another refers to God as Elohim.
Right.
And these had to be brought together. And that's also that book deals specifically with the Pentateuch.
Yeah, let me jump in with some of the specific problems with the Bible and the New Testament in a general sense, though. When you're talking about old books that have information in them, even oral legends that were written down later, there can be real information in them that is accurate. I don't think anyone would disagree with that. The difficulty with the religious types of materials comes in when you're talking about the magical, supernatural aspects of it. We can read the New Testament, and it mentions Pontius Pilate as a governor of Judea under the direct rulership of Rome.
Right.
Okay. There's other documentation that talks about that. Okay. So we know that was a real event.
Mm-hmm.
The New Testament talks about specific place names and buildings and things of that nature, which appear to be accurate. Though the Book of Mark gets some locations and directions messed up, demonstrating that person really never lived in the area. The difficulty is in the magical things. Archaeologically, you can go out and dig up some of these places that used to be and maybe find some things which match something you may have found in the New Testament.
Right.
But you can't go out and archaeologically dig up Jesus walking on water, or Jesus turning water into wine, or Jesus casting demons out of a person into pigs that, run
right.
off a cliff.
Supernatural statements.
There's you have to consider the information in a different categories. If you believe in magic and you believe magic happens all the time, then you have no trouble believing these sorts of things could have happened. But if you want to start from scratch to prove that they could have happened, it's a different case. And just in terms of the New Testament, I find it while a very fascinating book to read in several different kinds of translations. The more knowledge you gain of the times, the more you understand of the Jewish religion at that time, the more you understand of all the competing variants of the Jewish religion at that time, the Roman history of that time, the socioeconomics of the peasant culture that was in place at that time. Mm. You find more and more contradictions of what there is in the New Testament. I've gone through several phases of trying to figure out, okay, what sort of real person might be behind the Jesus story, and I've gone through several different kinds of versions, reading a number of different authors, and frankly, I've had to conclude that while I believe that there's probably some threads of information of a real person on whom the title Jesus Christ is based in the New Testament,
mm-hmm.
that you're just going to find it impossible to figure out what it is unless you take it a viewpoint that says this was a Jewish leader who was very popular, probably led to revolutionary tendencies, and he couldn't have been saying anything that was very contrary to Jewish religion at that time, and that leaves an awful lot of ground open. And aside from that, I don't think you can say anything else. I don't even think you can say that Jesus lived and died around 30, the year 30 of the current era, or maybe 100 or 150 years earlier, given how vaguely the letters of Paul talk about his life. There's just problem after problem after problem, contradiction after contradiction, and I think you can't know. And for that standpoint alone, even if I wanted to believe in magical beings and gods, I couldn't believe in the Christian religion based on what the New Testament is.
Right. I think we could probably prove and disprove anything that we really want to prove or disprove.
I don't agree.
Out of the Bible.
Well, I'm sorry.
Theology,
I was specific. I was pretty much referring to the Bible. Yeah, there are certain things that can't be disproved and certain things that can be proved. But as far as beliefs go, it is a lot easier to prove and disprove things like that. I started my graduate work in practical theology, and which you guys may not see very practical, but anyways, so that may be practical and theology may not go together well for you guys. But
well, at least you have better scholarly background than some of the creationists who call us up.
But you guys got to understand, most people can't handle, all three of you guys and I totally disagree on major areas. But I'm not gonna argue with you guys, because I'm not, my purpose is not to argue, and my purpose is also not to make, you know, proselytes. You know, I'm not trying to win you guys over. I just wanted to know what your definition with you know, mainly definition between atheism and agnostic, and then to try to get across the point. I think at some point we got to both, Christians also got to realize, to try to argue with you guys that God exists beyond a shadow of a doubt, and I think it's stupid. I really do, and I'm a very strong Christian. I've been one since I was 12 years old, and I more base my belief on faith, and I can say that, and if it makes me sound foolish, you know, I don't really care. I realize as a Christian that's, unfortunately, that's what it's about. Most religions are like that. You got to come to a certain point where you say, well, even kind of against some things that seem untrue, I'm still going to believe this.
Right. And I'm just curious.
Right.
And you're one of the, you know, most polite and level-headed Christian callers that we've gotten. So I'll ask you, because maybe you can give me a straight answer.
Sure.
Why do you do that? What gives you the idea,
right,
that faith can possibly be valid?
Right.
Because if you don't know, right?
Right.
If there's no evidentiary basis, then how can just deciding possibly be a valid way of finding truth?
The way I see it is I do believe that there's a lot of things that can be proven, and I do view the Bible. I mean, I've been studying it. No offense to you guys, but I mean, I have specifically been studying the Bible and religion for 4.5 years now. So, as regard to like whether the scriptures are accurate or not, I mean, I've been studying probably a lot more books than you guys have. I actually studied Greek, and I can account to the what we use as the Bible today is fairly close to the actual
okay.
Greek that was written.
So are you telling me that you base your faith on proof?
No.
Okay,
no.
That's not answering my question.
Right. Well,
you're telling me the proof is essentially irrelevant, right? That the thing you got to do is just believe, regardless of what the evidence says.
When the day is done and everything's said, yes.
Why? How can that possibly make sense?
Oh, okay, you as an atheist should totally be able to understand this, and any other Christian should too.
Why? No, we don't. Why?
Well, because
what do you think I'm doing that's like that?
We live in a natural world. Okay, here's an example. Another planet was just found, okay? It couldn't be seen before, but yet people continue to strive to see what else is out there.
Yeah.
At certain points in all of our lives, we do that. We come to questioning points. Who am I? What the heck am I here for? What am I doing? What's my purpose? Okay. I started doing that at an early age in my life. I'm a thinker. I probably would have studied philosophy if I never knew anything about Christianity, okay? I started thinking a lot about what the reason why I'm here. And for me personally, evolution and, which I don't know if they still teach it in school nowadays, but I was taught it when I was in school.
Yeah, they're still teaching evolution.
Right, okay.
It's still the backbone of biology.
Right.
Yeah.
When I learned that, for some reason, and I don't know why, maybe you guys would say it's just because of how I grew up in the society the community that I was around, but evolution just seemed to go contrary to something in me, and I just kind of thought, there's got to be some other reason, and maybe that made me ignorant.
I would like to vent.
Let me take this.
I know. We're both bursting.
You just said three different things, and that I could tell, and I'm going to try to respond to each and every one of them.
Okay.
First of all, the planet, the newly discovered planet.
Mm-hmm.
Had you asked me 2 weeks ago if I believed there was a planet orbiting
Epsilon Eridani,
I'd have said, well, no, I don't believe that.
Right.
What evidence would I have to believe that? So my point is that the time to believe a thing is after it has been proven to very probably be true.
Exactly.
And not before. If you start latching on things to believe before the weight of evidence indicates that it's probably true, you're just guessing. Okay? And so that's my question again about faith. Right? Either you base it on evidence or you don't. And you seem to have been making the case that the evidence is irrelevant. And so
it's not absolutely irrelevant. I kid, and I think you guys too would believe that besides that planet they just found is not the last planet that they're going to find.
No.
You know that there's going to be more.
Probably not.
Right. Okay,
do I believe they will find more?
I do.
I think it's very likely, it's very probably true.
Right, okay, see, well, and I'm glad that we're talking, this is a very good analogy, because this is the same thing with Christianity. The same way you were saying, well, I kind of believe, that was the same way that I came into Christianity, but there is a step that I made, and I can't fully explain to you exactly why I made it, but I just said, I'm going to commit to this step, the same way that you guys have committed to a step.
And that's, no, we haven't, though.
Well,
we haven't. I am fully prepared to believe in a God the instant that the weight of evidence indicates that there probably is one. Completely prepared.
That's
I have the slightest reluctance to do that.
That may be what you guys call atheism. That's not true atheism.
Wait. Excuse me. I believe that you're going to have to allow us atheists to tell you what atheism is.
Yeah, but listen,
and not have you make up a definition.
Well, like the same way that you guys, you guys do it with Christianity for every show that you're on. So just let me just say,
what was this about?
Okay.
The true atheist is not what you guys are describing. And with all due respect, you guys are a little bit watered down for atheists.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So you're saying that we kind of
we do take off the horns
God
and tails right before the show.
If you're saying you want to believe in a God... No, hang on.
Do you want to believe in a God?
I think it would be a fine thing.
I think it doesn't have anything to do with what we want.
I think it's a wonderfully appealing idea that there is a cosmic entity that created everything and cares deeply about what happens to me.
Is that typical?
That's a fine, wonderful, attractive idea.
You know, then I'm probably wrong. Is that typical to most atheists? Do they want to believe that?
Most atheists would quibble about the specific gods that have been proposed, right?
Right.
They wouldn't think it was a fine thing for there to be, say, a cosmic entity that will cause you to fry in hell for eternity if you don't happen to believe in them, right?
That's what you guys don't like. You would like the positive things to come out of it.
Well, if you're asking me, you asked me if I wanted to believe,
right?
Okay, and I'm telling you what I am willing to say.
Gotcha.
I think would be a good idea.
Okay,
right? Or a good state of affairs.
So when you find something that you like, then you'll say, "I believe it." You're basically looking at
because I just proposed to you a God definition that I think is a fine idea, and it would be a wonderful thing if that existed. But I don't believe it.
Right.
Because the time to believe a thing is after it has been shown to probably be true. You can't just make up ideas that are appealing to you and latch onto them and say, well, I'm going to go ahead and believe that because I find it appealing. Mm-hmm. Or you can, but if you do, then what you're doing is faith, and that's really, really a foolish way of going about determining what's
true. I don't think Tom's being foolish from his standpoint. Let me go back
actually,
and address...
Well, actually, faith in the Bible is referred to as being foolish, but go ahead.
Well, let me go back and address... something that Tom had mentioned twice, I think, in different forms.
Okay.
And that was the transition point of where you're making the commitment to go ahead and believe in this.
Right.
And you talked in terms of evolution and, you know, not feeling right to you. I'm probably putting words in your mouth, but something along those lines.
Yeah, that's all right. You know? I'm not the type to disagree with everything. Yeah, go ahead.
I think what you were describing is some internal discomfort, maybe is a way of putting it, or an internal unwillingness to accept what appeared to you to be a scientific type of presentation of reality as inadequate or not meeting your needs or something generally along those lines.
Right.
And I think that we need to, you know, atheists, and all of us, I guess, but atheists need to recognize that when Christians and other religionists talk about those motives are real to them.
Right.
And those motives count for them. And even though I would describe those motives as products of evolution in terms of instincts and behaviors, for you, those were the motivations that made you think that evolution wasn't a good enough answer for life, or that life needed to have a purpose in asking it that way.
Right.
And then we kind of got into talking about a little bit about maybe atheists just wanting to accept the nice part and not being willing to put up with the tough parts. You know, first of all, just from, you know, the easy answer is, you know, life isn't all that easy as an atheist when you're in a culture of people who believe, many of whom are perfectly willing to be hostile towards you.
Yeah, we make life hell for you guys.
But, you know, aside from that, you know, if everybody was an atheist, you know, there would still be a lot of things that we accept that we don't particularly like, you know. For example, the question of whether life does or should have a purpose. I think it would be wonderful if my life had a purpose, but I don't see any evidence that it does. And that's kind of a difficult and a hard thing to accept. I would like my life to be very meaningful, and I would like my thoughts and my feelings and everything to have weight and import, and the idea that somebody would be judging me and giving me a report card if I did good, you know, so that I get, you know, something good and counted out of this life. That's an appealing thought, but I don't think it's true, and it's kind of a hard thing to accept that you're just another kind of a life form to which nature is basically indifferent. Nature doesn't care whether I live or die. Mm-hmm. You know, it's only my evolved instincts that try to survive and reproduce that care about that.
Okay, you know? Wait. You just brought up something very good, nature.
Yeah.
Now, and I'm not just trying to catch you on a point, but you referred to nature as though it was a personage, and or a force, or something at least.
I think you're reading something into my words that's not there. When I talk about nature, I'm talking about a completely materialistic universe of orderly and consistent physical actions, which we try to describe with the laws of physics.
This is what I can't. This is what seems illogical to me as a philosopher, not as a theologian.
Mm-hmm.
How can order exist?
Can I take this, please?
How can order exist except for somebody authors the order?
Well, we'll explain how. Martin respond, and then we're going to have to let you go because we've got a bunch of other callers.
Yeah, yeah, and I appreciate you guys.
Appreciating the call, and we'd love to have you call again in future.
Okay.
Go ahead, Martin.
There is a great deal of discussion about this from many sources, but one of the most just practical definitions that I've come across was in George Smith's book, and he differentiates between the concepts of order and design. And a very good point that he makes is that order is simply something that is entailed by the nature of existence itself. Okay, if in order to exist, you've got to be something. Okay, your molecules have to take some kind of form, otherwise you've just got free-floating molecules, and you really have nothing. You have no object. You have nothing tangible that you can put your hands on.
Right.
Design is something something entirely different, and that deals with the whole idea of a guiding force behind the order, and that's a completely different question.
Right.
And the problem with a lot of the design arguments for God is that Christians make, whether it's analogical or teleological or whatever position you take, is that they don't necessarily point to what the arguers want them to point to. For example, some of the design arguments, if you were to just take them for the sake of argument, might not necessarily point to a creator that was the Christian God or a God of any kind. It could just be a giant machine or a highly advanced civilization capable of making worlds and life forms.
Right.
So it's a much harder thing to pin down. But also another excellent source, though, for the whole question of design in nature and why these designs are the result of natural processes occurring over time and not just a master planner can be found in the writings of Richard Dawkins, who's an Oxford Don. He's one of the leading lights in biology. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But you have to differentiate between order and design because they are not just the same thing. There are specific distinctions to be made between those two things.
Yeah.
And that's the Reader's Digest condensed version of the view. But
all right.
Hey, I appreciate your guys' time a lot, okay?
Yeah, all and right, call us back sometime.
I'll call you next Sunday if I skip church again, all right?
All right.
Sleep late. We're a good alternative.
All right, take care, man.
Okay, bye. Thanks.
And that was Tom on 4. Let's go to...
For Russell hung up. Sorry,
yeah, Russell. We lost Russell. Sorry, Russell.
Yeah.
Mark?
Mark on 2?
Hello, Mark.
This is Mark.
Hi, Mark.
Hi, boy.
What can we do
long
for you?
I'm waiting here.
Yeah.
We're
thanks
sorry.
A lot.
But
we'll try to go more quickly here.
I appreciate the discussion. I'll tell you what my objective is right up front. I'll be honest with you. I know I'm not going to change your minds, but I hope I can give you something to think about. I'm a person of faith. But I was wondering what type of positive proof you would need in order to believe there's a God.
Well, that's a good question.
Ooh, yes.
Because, I know of atheists who will say, gee, you know, I just can't conceive of anything that could possibly convince me. I'm not so sure, because I think that an omnipotent, omniscient, omni-everything being could probably come up with something that I wouldn't be able to weasel out of, you know? I'm not necessarily sure what that is, but...
Let me take a little easier.
Guess, yeah.
Let me take a little easier approach to it. As a complete materialist, I guess before I even get to the question of God, I'd have to believe that magical supernatural things exist. And by magical and supernatural, I mean things that can violate what we think of as the laws of nature in such a way as to make me think that there might possibly be some external entity or force outside that can do it. You know, for example, if you know, the moon were instantaneously turned into green cheese, you know, just before our next lander goes up to check it. Okay, to me, that's, you know, that's such a highly unlikely event that I would think that maybe that's good evidence that there was magic in existence. Either that, or there's some you know, alien race that has a really, you know, bizarre sense of humor. You know, so it would take an action or an event that I would regard as most likely being explained by magic, or that I certainly couldn't exclude magic as the most likely explanation. Okay, that would get me to the point of believing maybe magic existed, and that would be a step towards, you know, thinking that maybe a God existed, you know.
I think I got a slightly better response for you now, too. I've been sitting here thinking while Howard was talking. First of all, I hope you don't really assume that you can't possibly change our minds, because like I think we tried to explain to the last caller, we don't take this on faith. We're willing to go with whatever the evidence suggests, okay? We have not made a strong emotional commitment to, you know, atheism, period, no matter what. Any of us would be more than willing to believe in anything you can prove to us, okay? You still there, caller?
Yeah.
Is he? I don't hear him. Mark, you still there? No, I guess he's listening for his answer. Okay. I can tell you for sure what's not enough to convince me, okay? An old book is not enough. The evidence strongly suggests that an older a book is, the less likely it is to be true. I'm just talking in general terms now and not in specifics, but old books tend to be written by more and more primitive people who knew less and less and less about what was actually going on, who had worse communication, worse bookkeeping, worse grasp of natural laws. So you showed me an old book, I'm going to say that's going to convince me a whole lot less than a recent book based on current understanding. Personal testimony is not going to be enough to convince me, because anybody can say anything for all kinds of reasons, okay? One guy coming up here and telling me, well, one time I had this miracle happen to me, I'm sorry. If that's the only evidence that I have that miracles happen, it's not going to be enough. And finally, I'm absolutely not going to do what most Christians tell me they did, which is at some point just decide, well, I'm going to assume that God exists and the Bible is his word. I actually had this happen in an email discussion I'm having right now. This guy, Sammy, took exception to my webpage and wrote me an email, and at one point he said, well, you know, I'm not just some lunatic. I thought this through very rationally. I just started with the caveat that God exists and the Bible is his word, and then I've rationalized, I've come up with everything else rationally. I'm sorry, making that caveat isn't rational. The time to believe something is after the evidence proves that it's probably true. If you jump in assuming that the God exists and assuming that the Bible is his word, well, of course, then you've set yourself up in a position where you can interpret everything else you find out later from that perspective and try to make it fit.
Yes, no different than the UFO believers.
And if you take the even more extreme position that you're going to go ahead and continue to believe even if the evidence doesn't fit, like our last caller said, right? Well, that's just deeply irrational, and there's no way I'm going to do that. Those kinds of evidence aren't enough to get me to believe anything. But I could easily propose evidence that would convince me that there is a God who's the guy that Christians were talking about, only he's not omni-everything, he's like this really powerful actually existing entity, actually existing mm-hmm. physical entity, like an incredibly powerful space alien. I can think of evidence that would convince me of that. And so I think if the evidence of your religion is not enough to even convince me that any kind of God entity exists, even an incredibly wimpy one, right, then there's something deeply wrong with the evidence that you guys have available. Did you have any comments about this, or should we go to the next call?
Let me add one other thing that would be insufficient evidence, and that's your own internal perceptions, which cannot be confirmed by outside evidence.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Yeah, I mean, lunatics can see, you know, 10-foot-tall yes. men with three heads walking down the street. Yes. That doesn't mean they're really...
Yes, and I really think they're there.
Yeah, I was just only going to reiterate what Howard said. You know, you would have to have some sort of evidence that's super... that. Things that can happen that violate all known natural laws yeah. could happen at all before you could then take the step to believe in a supernatural deity. You know, the Bible makes a statement about, you know, if you have enough faith, then you can move a mountain or something to that effect. Well, it would take very few examples. I mean, if I were actually able to, you know, if I were standing around, you know, hanging out some one day outdoors with a Christian and he said, watch this, and this mountain nearby went plunk, okay, well... You know, I would find that rather persuasive.
Right. And instead, if he goes on a fundraising campaign and yeah. raises the money and gets earth-moving equipment, then it's not yeah. then it's not faith doing it. It's efforts, actual, you know, yeah. effort doing it via the abilities allowed us by natural law.
Right.
Okay. So, let's go to...
Angie or Colin?
Colin.
I think... Okay.
I think Colin? Colin.
Colin?
Yeah.
Hi, Colin.
Hey, Jeff. Say, earlier in the show, Howard demonstrated the law of gravity by dropping his glasses case,
yes.
but we didn't get a look at the water. He said that it wasn't going to turn into wine. Would you mind taking a sip or something? I'll take your word for it.
I can tell, well, first of all, the rules of the studio don't allow us to have anything to drink up here but water.
Oh, I
see. So I'd be breaking the rules and our show would be canceled if we were caught here with anything other than water, which I can't tip and show at the camera because the angle isn't right. But... if you're going to take my word for it, which you shouldn't, because it's just testimony, mm-hmm. just water.
Okay. Well, thanks for the basic course in epistemology. I didn't expect this on a Sunday morning, but some friends recommended the show. And back to something earlier in the show, the churchification of America.
Yes.
This is not a book I'm familiar with, but I'd like to hear more about it, because it came as a surprise to me to hear that one in six people were religious at the time of the foundation of the country. Right now, as an atheist, having grown up in the South, seeing all these religious people around me, the idea of a secular America seems almost as likely as, socialism taking hold and working. You know, you guys seem awfully optimistic. And anyway, I'd like to hear more about the how all this changed.
Well, yeah, let me go back to that point then. Okay.
Sure.
I was quoting some statistics that were in a book called The Churching of America, 1776 to 1990, by Fink and Stark, and that was Rutgers University, 1992. And it was a book basically talking about how the evangelical churches accounted for the rapid growth of religion in the United States. So this is a religious viewpoint. The 17% figure they came up with, and that's the best one I've seen that you actually got to use some data. I've seen estimates that religious adherence was anywhere from under 10% to 20% at that time. I think it would be inappropriate to take this as an overstatement, okay, of how little religion there was at the time. I think that what it probably is more likely telling us is that we had a frontier economy, people were spread out, they were doing other things. Church at that time with the Anglicans and the Congregationalists and the Presbyterians was a high church sort of thing. A lot of times you had to pay for your pews, which means that the people who could be involved tended to be in urban settings and had money. Most people didn't have that. I would be very surprised if this number meant that 80% or so of the people didn't believe in God back then. I think it's a much more of a statement that people were just not very religious and not very organized towards religion. I've recently begun to try to investigate the idea that one of the reasons we had such a godless constitution and separation of church and state at that time had to do with this very upper class church kind of thing that was going on back then. I think there may be a good case that can be made that proportionally church people supported the king and the Tories much more than they supported the revolution, and that it was this high church support of the king by the Tories that accounted as much as anything for the low level of religiosity at that time, and then the great flowering of Unitarianism out of Congregationalism after that, and then the rapid growth of the evangelical churches back then, like the Baptist and the Methodist, who were more democratic in their approach and not to church hierarchies that were tied to the kings and got their privileges from kings in England. So there's a whole story there that needs to be told, but all the evidence you find is generally written by church people that talk about the Great Awakening in the 1750s and things of that nature, and apparently sociologically and economically there's a lot more than that going on back at that time.
I see. And also, it's interesting that that religion is kind of vogue now, you know, that it's sort of acquired new impetus. I mean, Jesus is on Time once a month, the cover of Time or Newsweek.
Yeah.
And, Jesus sells, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, let's see. What other things have the great minds of America swung to before? I mean, we have these mass approaches to some sort of mania like this. I mean, there's a groundswell towards prohibition. Do you think this was just waiting to happen? Do you think it was latent, or do you think other social forces can be pointed to as a source of this religious groundswell?
Yeah, just very generally before we maybe get another caller in here.
Okay.
I think that in the United States, it's true that there have been two successful institutions, industry, commerce and capitalism, and then government, and that religion is kind of the one thing that is left for people to do and go to churches and have something that's separate from those other great powers in their life. Plus, we've had freedom of religion and separation of church and state, which has helped religion more than anything else.
Yeah, I would put it down largely to the gradual erosion of the quality of our public education system, which simply leaves people wide open for unfounded claims of the supernatural. I mean, I don't think it's any surprise that the rise of the New Age movement essentially went hand in hand with this explosion in religious fundamentalism. They're just two different manifestations of the same problem. People don't really understand what's going on.
Gotcha. Okay, well, thanks for the show.
Thanks for your call, Colin. Hope you will watch regularly. I just want to let him go there. On three. Was reminded by that new fan of the show. We have these "We don't hate you, we just think you're wrong" buttons, which Martin and I carry around in public.
That's
if you
right.
spot us in public and you come up to us and say you watch the show, we will offer you a button. This is our show's catchphrase, because mm-hmm. Christians are always telling us that we must hate them. Also, I want to remind everyone that at 11 o'clock this morning after the show, we're going to be at the First Cafeteria at North Cross Mall in the Longhorn Room. Today's speaker is going to be our own Arlo Pignatti, showing off his collection of strange religious paraphernalia.
I hope he brings some testaments. Those are
testaments. We've had those on the show too.
They're not bad.
Should I try to fit in one more call?
We got
2 minutes left.
Okay.
Stephen, if you have
Steve
something quick. Steve?
Yes.
Hi. Got something really quick?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I noticed Howard was saying there's contradictions in the Bible.
Yeah.
There are no contradictions in the Bible, but there are passages which people don't understand.
All right. Thank you very much for your call. We will respond to that.
Go to Vic. Perfect time for the websites.
Websites, Vic.
Let's get them up there. At this one here, skepticsannotatedbible.com. is a website that features the complete text of the Bible with the hyperlinks to over 270 Bible contradictions, as well as just other skeptical notations, you know, just inconsistencies, really weird things that don't seem to make historical sense,
This is a very good site to take a skeptical approach to the Bible.
And like Mark Twain said, it's not the parts of the parts of the Bible I don't understand that worry me. It's the parts I do understand.
And here are just a couple of other good websites of scientific and atheist interest. TalkOrigins.org, it deals with the evolution versus creationism controversy. Skeptic.com is the Skeptic's Dictionary, which talks about other, like paranormal, new agey, weird beliefs. And then infidels.org is just a good sort of central meeting place for atheists and unbelievers on the web.
Okay.
Yeah, just one last on that. I find it amazing that Jesus came to earth as God, picked his people, had him write it with divine words, and then we got to spend so much time rationalizing it to get it right.
It's like those space aliens that can't think of a better medium to draw their pictures than wheat fields. You know, it's completely silly.
Yeah. So, all
okay.
Right. Well, there we are. Another good show.
Yeah, another show under our belt, and thanks everybody on the crew.
Give us our love rings.
Hope we'll see atheists and atheist-friendly people at our lecture at First Cafeteria at 11 o'clock.
Adios, guys.
Christians,
we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong. Bye-bye.